Good afternoon. I'm just going to spend 20 minutes introducing you to a project that I'm working on called Stemcilla. I'd like to start off by acknowledging the support of the Alfred B. Sloan Foundation, who's made this work that we're doing possible, and also the attendance of this workshop. I'm going to start off by saying that I've got a severe case of imposter syndrome right now. When I saw the opportunity to sponsor this workshop, it looked like a good way to contribute to the community, relatively small amounts, and I didn't think I was going to be giving a talk straight after Kenty's very excellent talk. Some obviously the head of Missouri for research, so yeah, I know what imposter syndrome now means. I'm also not going to talk to you about high-performance computings or CFDs. I'm really coming from the other end of the spectrum of scientific research in terms of technical ability and, I suppose, computational levels. This is what the sort of research that I do. But in many ways, I think it's quite a good microcosm of the way that increasing data in our lives is affecting the way that researchers need to approach things. So I work in fishery science. This is a picture of some Maldivian pole and line fishermen. So they've been using this technique for catching skipjack tuna for hundreds of years. But as you can see, their boats are getting quite big. And so they're starting to catch more and more fish. These guys catch about 150,000 tonnes of skipjack tuna a year. It's all pole and line, so it's all eco-friendly. They're not catching turtles and things, but they're catching like around 75 million of these fish a year. So that brings into question the sustainability. And so the sort of work that we do as fishery scientists is to try and assess what sustainability is. And here you can see some pictures of the sort of simulations we do, looking at alternative control rules for managing fishery. So the context of where this project has come from is my work over the last 20 years as just a normal fishery scientist working with other people who aren't very computer literate but are increasingly having to deal with larger and larger amounts of data. And often when we think about research and research outputs, we think about a 12-page journal article, but where we were really finding difficulties with dealing with reproducibility was in the sort of 150-page project reports. Increasingly, we're being asked to produce summaries over multiple regions, multiple species, and so forth. And so, as was mentioned yesterday, the traditional approach to doing that is to create book graphs in Excel or in R and then copy and paste things across. And when you've got 150 pages of figures and tables, that becomes a real pain in the neck. So, the incentive for reproducibility, in many cases, it's not so much to be open and transparent. Many times it's just to be efficient and robust. So that when someone says, can you please go and change the way you extract the data or do some different grooming, then you don't have to go and do all that copy and pasting again. And in terms of the context as well, I think it's really important to appreciate that different people need different types of tools. So, many of the people in this room, all the people in this room, will be in this coders camp. They know how to use Markdown, LaTeX, Git, code-driven interfaces mainly. And they have a workflow which is generally highly reproducible. But most scientists are actually still in that clickers, what I call the clickers camp. They're using visual interfaces such as Excel and Word, using copy and paste, and they have little or no reproducibility at all. And I think also it's worth recognising the group in the middle, the scripters, the people that have bits of R code which they copy and paste around for various projects and share, but they're not using version control, they're still using copy and paste from R into Word. So I've become interested in not only how do we reduce the barriers to entry to reproducibility, how do we make it easier, but also how do we bridge the gap between those two camps, because that's a really important thing too. You want the coders who are able to contribute the more advanced numerics to a paper to be able to contribute, collaborate with domain experts who have some way of interpreting and providing some context. So, the approach that we've taken to solving this issue of bridging the gap between the coders and clickers is to say that we don't want to produce a tool that's just for one of those groups. Instead, we want to make a tool that has multiple interfaces. So on the left-hand side, you see an interface which is like a word processor. We can edit, and in this case, italicize some text. We've got an R, a cell, where we can push the name graph, and then we've got a little slider where we can change the graph, the smooth that we're applying to it. So it's very much like a Jupyter notebook, except that instead of having alternating cells of text and code, it's more like having Google Docs or Microsoft Word with code inserted into it. So you can do pretty much most of the text formatting that you can do in a normal word processor. But then on the right-hand side, we have the source for that file. And when you make changes on the left-hand side of the visual interface and press save, it gets saved to this as Markdown. And to support that, we have some Markdown extensions, but the point being that you can still have a plain text format that you can use version control, and the coders can collaborate with the clickers. We've taken that idea a step further when we presented this document type of interface. People were saying, well, who's going to write the code? Someone's still going to be writing the code. And what about all the people that are still using spreadsheets for their data analysis? And so we took that idea of just having code cells, and instead of having them in a document in a linear order, here what we're doing is presenting them in a grid-like interface, just like a spreadsheet. The difference here is that each of the expressions that I'm typing into each cell is actually an R expression. And what we do is we pass the R, we work out the dependency between the various cells, and when you change the cell, here we're taking the R squared out of the linear model, everything updates, so you have that React programming of a spreadsheet. So providing an interface which is familiar to non-coders, but provides a way for them to sort of dip their toe into that world. And again, we have on the right-hand side, a plain text format. So the spreadsheet has a visual interface, but also can be committed to something like Git. You probably aren't going to want to do a diff on that file. It's not that instructive necessarily, but certainly better than having something that's completely opaque. So we've got a desktop application which bundles all this stuff and you can download and use on the desktop. It's very beta, it's actually probably more like alpha, but you can go and have a look at that. But we've got this nice shiny desktop application, still very buggy, but it's shiny. So how do you take that and do reproducible research in the context of collaboration? How do you make sure that the system, the environment for your R or Python or whatever is the same as your collaborators? Well, how do you publish that research? How do you take that paper and then publish it in some of the more innovative publishers like eLife, GigaScience or F100 or F1000 who are interested in this idea of reproducible figures and reproducible executable papers? So the answer, of course, is to do some containerization. And so the tool that we've been working on more lately is something that we call Sybil. And what Sybil does is just grabs a bundle, similar to what Kenji was talking about, a bundle of assets, a bundle of files, and they can be from various resources. It could be a DAT archive, it could be a GitHub repository or whatever. And there's only sort of 500 lines of bash code here, just using existing tools, Docker and so forth. We can bundle that up into a container and then we deploy it with Kubernetes. So what does that look like? At the top you have just a file system directory on my computer, which has got a CSV and a README. You just say civil launch, that file directory, and it grabs it, takes a SHA of the content of that directory, checks to see whether it's already got an image built for that bundle. If it doesn't, then it creates a new Docker image, puts the contents of that bundle into the image, and eventually just launches it. And because this is on my laptop, it's just launched a local Docker. And that image I can go and have a look at. So that's sort of boring, just doing stuff off your file system. But we're looking at a whole lot of schemes to grab things from Dropbox or Bitbucket or wherever. The bundles at the moment, we have a way for resolving what the main document that we're going to present to the user is. It could be a main.star file or an index.star file. And currently we're supporting a number of different formats. We have our own extensions to HTML, but where we embed the code cells. I showed you the Markdown previously, and we've got preliminary support for Markdown and iPython notebooks as well. And then we have the ability to also add to that bundle some customization of the image. So you can set a package JSON if you're using Node or requirements.txt for Python. As I said, it's not very interesting just going off the hard drive, so this example shows you taking a shared folder off Dropbox. Again, making it really easy for scientists to take the existing tools that they're using and share a folder with someone, paste in the shared folder ID and get it going. In this case, it's gone and grabbed the bundle, taken a shower of it and seen that there's there's already an image built for that version of the bundle, and so it just immediately launches the session. So not everyone wants to use the command line, so we just have a simple web wrapper around that. This is very beta at the moment, so it's just pretty much wireframe, but you put your address in at the top and press open, and it goes through that whole process. And in this case, we're got it deployed on the Google Cloud, and so it's using the Google Cloud Container Registry to check to see whether it's already built that bundle for that particular share of the content. And when you open it up, you get the URL with a JSON web token that allows us to do the routing, the same document that I showed you before, and that's fully executable, just like Kendi was saying with that. Python notebooks, Jupyter notebooks, so you can interact and edit that file in place. Behind the scenes, as I said, we're using Kubernetes and Docker. As many people have said, these tools make it really easy to do this sort of thing. So there's not a lot of complexity here. There's some pretty funky stuff going on with using Docker and Docker, and there's some issues there that we still need to resolve. But essentially just spawning up a container within the Kubernetes cluster for each user's bundle. So in terms of next steps, what we're looking at doing is we're really, again, coming back to our end user, the people that this is designed for, we really want to make it easy for people to be able to take their existing R environment or Python environment, their document bundle, and essentially deploy a container for it. And so we're looking at ideas like this, where we have some packages for various languages and being able to capture the current environment of R or Python. And here it shows the current R environment on my machine. So can we turn that JSON file then into a Docker image so that we're essentially replicating as closely as possible the environment that's on the user's machine? We're also looking at turning this into something like Travis CI for clickers. So can we get people used to the idea that if they put some test assertions into their documents and are using GitHub, that every time they push to their GitHub repo, that we can trigger builds and notify them when there's something wrong with their documents. So again, we're not targeting the coders who are writing in a test, but rather the the clickers, the everyday scientists who aren't doing any unit testing of any kind, at least this would be a step up in the right direction. And the final thing that we're looking at, that I'm going to go over today anyway, is the idea of building comprehensive images. So my feeling is that in most cases, there's a fairly restricted set of packages that most scientists are using for basic data manipulation, statistics and plotting. And so can we build images that meet the needs of those 90% of use cases, allowing people to customise if they need to, but having builds off those images, doing them daily, and allowing people to pin to a certain date. So essentially data version control of whole environments for doing this sort of basic data science. So I'll just wrap up to say, all this is open source and available on GitHub. Love to get contributors and also beta testers. It's all pretty rough at the moment, but if you'd like to help out, come talk to me or email me. Thanks.